She creates that batch file and she schedules it to run a week after she leaves, a little present she leaves behind for us. She leaves. A week later, five machines have most of their hard drives erased, triggering a shutdown of the water treatment plant. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Waterfall's Industrial Security Institute. I'm Andrew Ginter with Waterfall Security Solutions, and in this series of videos, we are working our way through the top 20 cyber attacks on industrial control systems. We're using the top 20 attacks to compare the strength of two security postures for a hypothetical water treatment plant. One security posture is software-based. It's sort of vintage, classic 2013 advice. The other security posture uses a unidirectional security gateway. It replaces the IT/OT firewall in the 2013 posture, a single change, with a single device, a unidirectional security gateway that is the only connection between the industrial network and the IT network. Today's attack scenario is malicious outsourcing. Lucky 13, this is attack number 13. In this scenario, we have a vendor who is providing support, who is managing their software at customer sites all over the world. And our hypothetical water treatment plant, protected by these two security postures, has decided to use this vendor's outsourcing services. This happens routinely. People, you know, in the power generation space, vendors routinely monitor and manage the steam turbines. In other spaces, the vendors might manage, you know, complex pieces of software like historian databases or large OPC servers. This is a very common thing. So in this scenario, we have a vendor who is continuously monitoring their product at the water treatment plant through layers of firewalls. And the vendor is doing this monitoring from a central control facility, a central station. The vendor has chosen the city for their central control center so that in the city there's a large population of inexpensive labor with the skills that they need to staff the control center. I mean, they can put the control center anywhere in the world that they want. Why not choose a city that is affordable? So they do this. So here's the scenario. One of the technicians at this control center has, not surprisingly, got a better offer somewhere else because, you know, the technician is not very well paid. And before she leaves, she decides to take revenge on our water treatment plant. Why? Because one of the people at our water treatment plant complained about the technician's performance to her manager some months ago and got her a bad review. This is one of the reasons she's leaving. Before she leaves, she does us a little favor. She has permission to log into our water treatment plant, into the OPC server or the historian or whatever piece of equipment they are managing for us. She uses the VPN connection, the encryption credentials, the two-factor authentication, the username and password, all of the permission she has to log into as many computers on the water treatment plant's industrial network as she has permission to log into. It might be two, it might be three, it might be five computers. Logs into these computers. These are all Windows boxes. Windows is ubiquitous in water treatment plants. And creates a little batch file. The batch file contains one command, remove recursive C:\***, which deletes everything that this technician has permission to delete. She won't have permission to delete everything, but she'll delete enough that the whole thing isn't going to work anymore. She creates that batch file and she schedules it to run a week after she leaves, a little present she leaves behind for us. She leaves. A week later, five machines have most of their hard drives erased, triggering a shutdown of the water treatment plant. So, in terms of sophistication, this is a low sophistication attack. This is someone who's, you know, created a one-line batch file, has not written entire attack tools, has not downloaded attack tools, has written a little file and left it behind as a surprise, using permissions, not exploiting vulnerabilities, exploiting permissions. What are the consequences? Probably a plant shutdown. It'll probably take hours, if not a day or three, to find the backups and restore these servers from backup, and then we're back up and running. Does the city have enough water in storage to survive an outage like this? Do they have other treatment plants they can draw on in the meantime that can, in an emergency, supply enough water to the city? Do they have to issue a boil water advisory? Who knows? It depends on the circumstances of the city. But we're looking at probably a shutdown and certainly a cleanup that's going to cost us, because we got to bring experts in to figure out what happened and were other machines affected and can we still trust the industrial control system. How do our security programs hold up to this class of attack? Well, let's look at the classic 2013 software-based defensive posture. This technician logged into the jump host over a VPN from a machine that was protected by antivirus and right up to date security update wise, used the two-factor authentication, logged in, didn't steal anything, didn't steal permissions, logged into the three or five machines she had permission to log into, and left us a little surprise, using tools on those machines she had permission to use. There's nothing suspicious about that. The intrusion detection system's not going to fire. Nothing's going to fire. This technician logged into these systems routinely every few months for the last 3 years. This is normal. Antivirus is not going to catch anything. It's a one-line script. There's no signature for that. It's brand new. You know, security updates are not going to help us because there were no vulnerabilities taken advantage of. It was permissions. So the 2013-based security posture does not reliably defeat this class of attack. In the unidirectional scenario with a unidirectional gateway at the IT-OT interface, well, the gateway can replicate, servers can replicate monitoring information out so that the control center in another city on another continent can continuously monitor the historian or the turbine or the OPC server and diagnose problems. But if one of those technicians wants to log in to the industrial site to fix problems, well, the gateway is not going to let that login happen. The gateway is not physically able to send any signal back into the control system. So, how is this done? Well, most commonly, and there's several ways to do this, but the most common way is called remote screen view. What the technician does is pick up the phone, call the industrial site, the water treatment site, and say, I need to make some adjustments to the OPC server. There's a problem building up. Can I have an hour at 3 o'clock on Thursday? And makes an appointment. And when the time comes, somebody sits down, usually an engineer sits down at a relevant workstation, like an engineering workstation, remotes into the OPC server and calls the vendor and says, okay, you know, I'm ready for you. It's 3 o'clock. They know who they're calling. Okay, they're not calling, they don't have a random voice on the phone. They're calling the vendor for their scheduled appointment. And the vendor says, okay, bring up, you know, activate remote screen view. And they press a button and turn on, taking pictures of the engineering workstation and sending those pictures out to a web server on a video feed so that the remote technician can see the pictures and can give advice. Okay, bring up the diagnostics. No, that's communications diagnostics. Two further down, they can see the mouse moving. Okay, that's the system diagnostics. Bring that up and can guide the engineer through a process of fixing whatever's broken. If the engineer wants to leave a surprise, delete star dot star, and gives the engineer that advice, hey, create a batch file for me and put delete star dot star in it. Is that going to work? That's not going to work. No engineer is going to follow ridiculous advice like that. So the unidirectionally protected network, that security program, does reliably defeat this class of malicious outsourcing attack. Here's our score sheet. Again, the cyber design basis threat line is the boundary between the attacks that are reliably defeated below the line and the attacks above the line that are not reliably defeated. So we can see a significant difference here. There's a significant improvement in security with a single change, deploying a unidirectional gateway. And what we're doing here is demonstrating how to use the top 20 attacks to explore the difference between two apparently very similar security postures by asking which of these attacks are reliably defeated by each security posture. That's what I had for you for this episode. Thank you for joining us at Waterfall's Industrial Security Institute. A reminder to download the top 20 white paper. There should be a link right below the video here if you want the full list of attacks. You'll watch to the end of the video here. I hope you found it useful. If you did, please give us a like and subscribe. Thanks again. We'll catch you next time.